Indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Chairman, I would ask that you consider adding to the agenda under new business, authorization to proceed with jail courthouse SLOSS 7 project, providing for solicitations for the construction manager at risk and geotechnical testing.
So moved, as item number four?
Yes, sir.
Second.
Item number four, just a second, if you're looking, okay. Got a motion and a second, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, with the commissioner and the absent. Any other changes?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask that we postpone item public hearing number 14 until the September 6th public hearings.
Until September 6th?
Yeah, the next public hearings, Chairman. September 16th?
Yes.
Do we have a motion? Do we have a second?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to remind you that I accuse myself of this vote this time.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-0. Commissioner Amos recused, and Commissioner Tam absent.
Mr. Chairman, I go along with that item as old business number one, postpone it to September 6th.
Second, please, to catch up with the...
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Again, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to remind you that I accuse myself of this item.
If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-0, with Commissioner Amos recused, and Commissioner Tam absent. Any other changes?
Mr. Chairman, I have a few. The board will consider these.
Thank you.
First of all, I'm going to bring to your attention, I passed out at the podium a copy of a sewer reservation agreement between Forsyth County and Spartan Investors LLC. This is an agreement that the board approved at the July 24th, 2002 meeting work session. I would like to ask that this be placed on the agenda this evening under old business, and that a vote be taken, if you're agreeable, to put it on the agenda to rescind it for the time being, because I believe we think it will premature to do an agreement right now, because what we're agreeing to do is delay sewer acquisition until final plat. And so I think approving it on July 24th put us in a position of having an approved agreement but not accepting funds. And so I'm going to ask that you all rescind it, and then we will also ask that a letter be issued allowing the developer at risk to buy the sewer late, if that makes sense. So that's my request. And we can talk about it more if we can just make it on the agenda.
So moved.
What item on the agenda?
It would be...
Old business one.
Old business number one, and that would be...
We could two now, because we postponed one.
We deleted one.
They postponed it, so...
There is one?
I believe we have a motion, and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, with Commissioner Tam being absent. Any other change? You said a few, Council.
I did, Mr. Chairman. I have presented to you up on your podium, this would require a unanimous vote of the board. They are two resolutions of the Board of Commissioners asking for an increase in the county's state EPD water allocation, and also a resolution requesting a storage contract with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, something that Commissioner LeVan and I have been working on, and would need a forfeit vote to add this on the agenda this evening.
For my agenda.
And that would be at the end of new business.
So you make the motion?
Yeah, I make the motion. So moved, added.
And I will second it.
Out of five. Now we got four.
We have a motion and a second.
I don't know, that capo, are we just talking about water? We're not talking about contracts.
I'm not talking about anything having to do with water contracts involving any other entity like that.
So, good. Thank you. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, with Commissioner Tam being absent. Any others, Ken, or anyone else?
Mr. Chairman, just one more, and this goes to our alcohol hearings. We have had a request on alcohol hearing. I believe it's item G, which is the public supermarkets. We've got Carlisle Pride as the named employee, Joseph Formby as the named licensee. The attorney for Publix has submitted a request that this be postponed until the September 6th public hearings. Is the attorney here?
Yes.
Am I getting that right?
That's correct.
And they have requested that be postponed, Mr. Chairman.
Do I hear a motion? I make a motion that we postpone that item until September 6th.
Second.
Both the licensee and the employee. So yes, sir, GI and GI.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0 with Commissioner Pam being absent. Any other changes? Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as amended and changed?
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tim being absent. All right. Chair would entertain a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meeting. I'm sorry, my mistake. Any announcements and reports?
Chairman and members of the board, we would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures.
Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outburst applause or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comment portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. We have 1 public comment speaker signed up this evening. That speaker is Rebecca Ricks.
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm here again tonight to speak on the lost cats in hopes that anyone that is doing business with the city of Cumming would recuse themselves. As we most of us are aware, the city of Cumming receives 15% of the loss, and they only have a little over 3% of the population of the county. So I am asking again, and I will be back to ask again, that if you are doing business, personal business, with the city, that you recuse yourself. The citizens of Forsyth County deserve that. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
There are no further speakers, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Jim.
I have a comment, if I may. I have to get a little bit of praise for a fire from yesterday. A little bit after 4 p.m. the storms built up, and none of us knew the extent to which it was going to be building up. We had 7 homes that had wind and tree damage extensive. 4 structure fires, 2 homes, which may be, I guess, total losses. The firefighters did an incredible job, and one of those fires are on for about 4 hours. So I really feel sorry for the owners of these homes and the children of these homes. I got to tell you, I visited one of them yesterday, and I got to tell you, it was rich run. Just really thankful nobody got hurt during those fires. That being said, thank you for your great work yesterday, Chief.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Adoptions of the minutes. Chair entertains a motion to adopt minutes of the regular meeting July 19th, 2012.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, call on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tan being absent. Chair would entertain a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and the executive session of July 24th, 2012.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent. Consent agenda. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent. And now I believe the public hearings. Request approval of the pawn shop. Director of Planning and Community Development.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, application PW120031. This is located in Commissioner District Number 5 as a request for approval of a pawn broker license for JJ Pawn Shop LLC. DBA JJ Pawn Shop, name licensee is John M. Adams. The location is 1810 Buford Highway, Street Number 3. The application is in order.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Tom. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor, I'm sorry, that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Hannity being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this item? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Now, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Hannity being absent. And I would like to make a motion that we approve upon shop license of J.J. Pond LLC doing business as J.J. Pond Shop at 1810 Buford Highway Suite 3. Name licensee is John M. Adams, PW120031.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Hannity being absent. Item number two, approval of an alcohol license, Director of Planning and Community Development.
Yes, this is public hearing 2A, AL120570, located in Commission District Number 5. The request is for approval of an alcohol license for Yang Li Enterprise, Inc., doing business as Dragon Gate. Name licensee is Hu Ye Lin. Application to sell malt beverages and wine for consumption on premises at their place of business located at 3280 Keithbridge Road, Suite 1D. The information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tam absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this application for license? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. This is also District 5, so I would like to make a motion that we approve the alcohol license for Yang My Enterprises, Inc., doing business as Dragon Gate. Name licensee is Quay Yang Lin. Application to sell malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on the premises, AL120570.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent. Item number B, Zafran LLC.
AL120571. This is located in Commission District Number 2. The request is for approval of an alcohol license for Zafran LLC, doing business as Zafran. The main licensee is Chandra Shikhar Ropala. For an application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on premises at their place of business located at 2255 Callaway Court, Suites 100 and 200. The information contained in the application is consistent with Ordinance 68. For a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you, Tom. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Please vote on the motion.
Second.
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 Second. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this licensee?
This is Chandra Shikhar Ropala. I'm the applicant.
Yes, sir.
I'm here for this, but I don't know what to think.
You're in favor of this?
Yes.
Okay. Unless you have more to say about why you're in favor of it, that's all you need to say.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you'll stand by in case there's somebody against it that you may answer a question for, we'll see if anyone else wishes to speak in favor of this. Anyone in opposition to this application or license? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll take care of this. Mr. Tan is absent. I make a motion that we approve the request for an alcohol license to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on the premises for Zafran LLC, doing business as Zafran. Name licensee is Sandestra Rapala, AL120571.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. Which passes 4-2-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. We're on to item number three, proposed changes to the Forsyth County Alcohol Ordinance 68.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is the first public hearing regarding changes to the alcohol ordinance. The changes are geared towards streamlining and simplifying the renewal process for our alcohol renewal license, alcohol applications. Currently, our license is a calendar year license, runs from January 1st to December 31st. And the renewal deadline for an applicant to submit is October 1st. In addition to that application, each applicant is required annually to do a criminal background check and pay a $350 investigative fee. We follow that up with a public hearing at the board's last regularly scheduled meeting in December. That's a brief summary of our current process. In doing some research and talking to surrounding communities, found fairly consistently that surrounding communities process these renewals as a administrative function that happens at the staff level when there are no changes to the application. And that, in a nutshell, is the proposal before you tonight. This is less administrative work for the staff. It is fewer agenda items on commissioners' agendas. And most importantly for our applicants, it makes a couple essential changes that are in their favor. The first, it moves that deadline that I mentioned before on October 1st back to the second Monday of December. For our applicants, these renewal fees can be fairly significant and allowing them to keep that money in their outlet for longer rather than having to pay 3 months early is a favorable change. It also proposes that a criminal background check will be run every other year as opposed to every year. So the process of providing those documents, going through the check and paying the investigative fee would only happen every other calendar year from now on if adopted as written. The schedule we are planning is we would have a hearing tonight if things continue to move forward, a second public hearing in September, and then later that month we would send out an updated renewal notice to our applicants informing them of the new process and implement that process for the 2013 renewals. I'd ask that you conduct the hearing, and I'll be here to answer any questions on the board. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I could just ask a question before we go to the public hearing on page 17, the first page actually of the changes. Item 9.
Yes.
It says the application shall be accompanied by a certified cashier's check for the amount of the fee. Could we, and Councilman, if you'll give some input here, could we add in there that they can also pay with a credit or debit card? That's considered certified funds. It might make it easier for somebody if they need to finance it themselves by the credit card.
From the standpoint of where we are in the process, that's not such a substantive change that would require any additional public funds.
That's okay with the board. We could add that in
there. Mr. Bill, I would ask that in all sections of the ordinance,
we can
not just section 9.
Then I would make a motion if we add any time a payment is made by an applicant. Is that correct? Sorry.
Yes. We're probably going to have to go ahead and get this one done now, and we may have to bring that one back. It's a great comment.
But I think it's in some other changes in this.
Well, we'll change anything included in this document, then we'll incorporate that into
it. Yes, that's what, then not throughout the entire, but anything here.
That was my fault proposing that.
That's okay. That'd be my motion.
Thanks.
Or do we not need this motion?
Yeah, you do need that as a motion when you approve. You make the motion to approve it, then add that as an amendment.
Thank you, Chair.
Tom, I do have one question. Since we're going for 2 years for the background check, in a case where, let's just say, because of the nature of the press or something, it becomes painfully obvious that someone has been convicted of some sort of a crime, in between these times. Is that something that can be brought to light, or is just legislatively not one of the possibilities because of our two-year situation?
I believe that we could address that. The biennium background check would be a convenient opportunity for us to go from top to bottom of every applicant. But if we were aware of something, our ordinance calls out there are certain things that disqualify you from holding a license, and I believe we could act on that.
I agree. There's not only the automatic prohibitions, but the language is very clear that if the Board of Commissioners believes the applicant for any reason will not obey our laws, then they have the right to consider that. So it's not an automatic disqualification, but it's certainly a point of information that you can consider.
Okay, thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, the clerk has just reminded me this is the first public hearing, so forgive me for articulating, and you can make a motion this evening. It'll be the next public hearing.
Okay. If there are no
on the approval, on the, if you want to go ahead and ask the next version, come back to you, that's fine.
That?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Is there a what's that? Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. Is there anyone who wishes to speak about this new alcohol ordinance in favor of it? Anyone wishing to speak against it? Anyone with any comment about it at all? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to ask the county attorney to add in and bring back at the second reading that wherever a payment is required, which changes the person can pay by credit in their apartment. I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no conversation, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. Item number 4, the second reading of an ordinance regarding substances that mimic marijuana.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is a second public hearing this evening regarding a proposed new ordinance to Forsyth County that would ban what we were calling unregulated marijuana substitutes or synthetic cannabinoids that are otherwise not regulated by state law. This ordinance does something a little interesting in that it recognizes, first of all, that with respect to so-called K2 or spice compounds, which are otherwise already made illegal by state law, including state law enactments as late as 2012, and including a new ruling by the Georgia State Board of Pharmacy that tried to keep catching up with the synthetic compounds that are otherwise known as spice or K2 or synthetic cannabinoids, that they are illegal under state law. And we understand that the Board of Commissioners cannot make something illegal that is already criminalized under state law. But there was an interest by the Board of Commissioners in trying to nonetheless capture the ever-evolving chemical compounds that are used to create and manufacture these drugs, and therefore tasked me with attempting to do that, which I have done. So if you look on page 3, section 55 of the proposed new ordinance, we are regulating a substance called unregulated marijuana substitutes, which means the compounds or substances, whether described as tobacco herbs, incense, spice, aromatherapy, incense, bath salts, potpourri, herbal smoking blends, plant food, aromatic substances, etc., that are not currently a Schedule 1 controlled substance, right? Because that's already regulated by state law. If these substances, though, that we are describing are properly compounded with the specific intent to circumvent the criminal penalties for synthetic cannabinoids, we are making those illegal. If they are used to emulate, stimulate, or mimic the effects of marijuana or synthetic cannabinoids through chemical changes, such as the addition, subtraction, or rearranging of a radial radical, or the addition, subtraction, or rearrangement of a substituent. It's basically a chemical analysis. It is complicated, but it's meant to fill what I would consider to be a hole in the regulatory process, and that is the fact that these chemicals are ever-changing, and it is difficult for, I believe, the law to catch up with it. So what we're saying is, if the state regulates it and has rendered it specifically illegal, we are not doing that. If the state has not regulated it and declared it illegal, we are regulating that to the extent it is intended to mimic these synthetic cannabinoids. This would be a second public reading, Mr. Chairman. The Board of Commissioners is authorized to enact this evening, and it would contain our standard code violation provisions, which would be a first fine, would be $1,000 or imprisonment for a period not to exceed 60 days. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ken, I have a question, especially because of issues that have unfortunately been in the news lately about Lake Lanier. If someone had this substance that was acquired in another county, let's say it was in a boat and came over somewhere on some boundary of Lake Lanier, what would you expect the enforcement to be or not to be of our
We would still, to the extent that on Lake Lanier, that would probably be either DNR or the sheriff. And to the extent that the sheriff was aware of this code and understood how it worked and had been fully briefed on it, I'm sure his officers would attempt to regulate it. But the trick, of course, is going to be to find the substance, and then it will have to be chemically analyzed, and it will have to also be a finding or proof of the intent, what it was intended to be used for. But the statute is very, the ordinance is very clear that if that person uses, sells, gives, manufactures, intends to sell, possesses, purchases, delivers, transports, or distributes what we may very well declare illegal, they would be in violation of this ordinance. So I would assume that most of these substances, if confiscated by the sheriff's office, are sent to some sort of chemical analysis, either with the GBI or some other law enforcement agency, if they are found to not be within the range of those Schedule I drugs that are already made illegal, then this would be a fallback provision that we could say, okay, well, that's not specifically prohibited by state law because of the chemical composition. However, there's this other code we have in the county that says, even though the law is not caught up to us yet and that chemical compound is not illegal, this code renders it illegal because you were attempting to do the same thing with it that Schedule I drug does.
Okay, and then I realize these are perhaps, I'm not attempting to split hairs, but there are real world issues, and that is, supposing there is a company for whom this is legal in another county, but that county and that company is distributing this on roads that go through our county in order to get it to the other county. That's going to make them potentially in violation of our law. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. And then comes the question of, does anyone have a concern about trying to synchronize the list of things, for example, with the city of Cumming, because otherwise we could get into that situation?
Presently, this would not, this would only apply to the unincorporated areas of the county, so it would not apply to the city of Cumming, and I'll defer to
However, you. They got to deliver right through our county to get there.
Pardon me?
They have to deliver through our county to get there. They're okay. At risk.
There have been some instances where we've tried to get some unanimity on those ordinances. We can reach out to them.
And we ought to start someplace. I mean, even if there are corner cases or odd situations.
So. I would say if we approve this, the motion would maybe also ask Councilor to reach out to the city attorney and ask him if he'd present it to the city.
All right, is there a motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the item. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos being absent.
I'm
sorry.
I didn't accuse myself.
Commissioner Tam, I apologize. Pardon me. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this ordinance? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Anyone wishing to make any kind of comment at all? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam, absent.
Mr. Chairman, I have a motion to approve the ordinance regulating substances that mimic the effects of marijuana or synthetic cannabinoids, also known as Schedule K2, that are all otherwise not regulated by state law, as presented by the attorney. Furthermore, ask the county attorney to reach out to the city attorney and ask the city council to consider this.
Second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-2-0. Commissioner Tammy, next.
I'd like to add one thing. Furthermore, since this was Mr. Commissioner Bell's, is the one that brought this forth, if we see much of our end, this actually is holding up and this is working well, that you might want to contact other counties in our surrounding area, let them know this is working.
Thank you. Item number five.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item number five is a second reading of proposed modifications to the Forsyth County Animal Control Ordinance. These are modifications actually required by state law changes to the definition of dangerous dog, vicious dog, and potentially dangerous dog. You have in your agenda packet a very heavily edited version of the existing regulations in the Forsyth County Code related to dangerous dogs and vicious dogs. I could walk you through each of them, but I think what I'm going to do, if you're agreeable, is just go through the highlights as opposed to getting into the weeds of every specific change. The biggest change, of course, is that there is no longer going to be a definition of a potentially dangerous dog. That is going to be subsumed in the definition of a dangerous dog. Dangerous dog will be, if you will, the first threshold of a dog classification, and then that would then elevate to a vicious dog. And in fact, the new law goes so far as to say that if you had a dog classified prior to July 1st, 2012 as a potentially dangerous dog, it will now become a dangerous dog, and there will therefore be the two classifications of dangerous versus vicious animal.
Councilor, may I interrupt you? Can you please explain to everybody exactly why we're having to do this? Why we're going to do this?
Oh, we're having to do it because the state law sets the minimum thresholds. Our ordinance needs to emulate the state law. We don't have the ability to deviate.
I just want everybody to understand we're not generating this. We're having to do this based on the line of the state law.
Correct. We are doing it to the line of the state law. So those are the two significant changes. There's also various new definitions of what is a severe injury versus what is a serious injury. There are new changes with respect to the notification requirements of owners of animals that have dogs that have either been impounded or that have bitten individuals. There are new requirements with respect to hearing procedures for the classification of an animal as a dangerous or vicious dog. There are new changes with respect to how vicious and dangerous dogs have to be penned or kept at the home of the owners. There are also additional changes with respect to insurance requirements. There's even a change that states if you have a dangerous or vicious dog and move into this county with that animal, you must notify the county within a certain period of time of that new classification. Almost akin to sort of like certain sexual offenses having to register. It's almost the same sort of situation with some of these vicious and dangerous dog classifications. So it's fairly significant modification. There's also some new language that provides that no certificate of registration for a vicious dog will be issued to any person that has engaged in a serious or violent felony, or has engaged in dog fighting, or otherwise is engaged with Schedule I drugs such as cocaine, marijuana, methamphetamine, or ecstasy. So it's a fairly significant modification to the dangerous and vicious dog requirements. But again, we are changing our code merely to comport with state law. And that's all we're doing here, Mr. Chairman. This is a second public hearing. The board would be authorized to approve these modifications after this public hearing.
Thank you, Council. Chairman, entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tammy absent. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Animal Control Ordinance? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Does anyone have any comments at all?
I do, Mr. Chairman. Although I know that we have to approve this to align ourselves with the state law,
and a lot of wires is too. I have spoken with multiple different animal, I guess, rescue agencies as well as Humane Society, and they have parts that they're very, very concerned with. So I would just make the comment that we're probably going to see some of these organizations get with the state delegates and try to tweak this a little bit in the future. And I agree with them on some of the parts. They're a little bit harsh, and they are going to put some owners of animals that are not necessarily vicious at all to go by.
I would hate to know, for whatever reason, I'll put somebody in a bind.
Well, I don't think we have a choice but to align ourselves to state laws of the problem. However, I would be happy that I'm going to be working with them, with the state delegates, to try to clean up some of those concerns.
Well, I think I can work. I guess I'll ask it this way. Somehow, do you live without this? Is this something that we must vote on tonight?
The new law became effective July 1st, 2012, so we're actually about a month later than I would have preferred to have been. I wouldn't want to postpone it too very long at all. I want to make sure that our codes are as consistent with state laws as they can be. If the board would like to postpone it till perhaps the next regular meeting, just to solicit some input, that is certainly fine with me, but we need to get it adopted.
Okay, with the board's permission, I think I'm seeing some people who would like to make a comment about this.
Sorry, we can hold up a hearing for action.
Sorry, we're in the public hearing portion, I was going to say. Is it okay if we allow, I sort of said, if you have a comment, nobody came forward, but it looks like somebody would. Do you have a comment, Matt? No.
I'd like to say something real quick. Okay. You said anybody has a comment, and Mr. Levin made a comment. So my name is David Huter. I live at 1820 Valley Brook Drive in Forsyth County. I have not read the ordinance, so I don't know specifically what it says, but I will say that as somebody who has a neighbor with a dog that is in this category, I don't know whether it's just dangerous or whether it was potentially dangerous, but if it my neighbor, they have a little sign with a number in their window. And they live right next to me. I have two small children. I don't know that the ordinance can be too restrictive. This dog that they have will come up to the edge of the fence, and it can put its head up over the fence in their backyard. If that fence needs to be higher, then by all means, I don't have a problem with it. You know what, if they have to incur costs to make that fence higher, I think that's a good thing. Like I said, I've got two small kids. I fenced my yard. They complained when I fenced my yard. Their dog bit somebody, and then they went and put up their own fence. So
yeah, I think the concern that some folks have is, I agree with you wholeheartedly for the safety of all, but I think some folks' dogs are going to be deemed dangerous, and the difference isn't here. They don't have provoked or unprovoked. And if you've seen animals before, they're beaten on and beaten on and beaten on, if they finally bite, should they be deemed, or otherwise they never would have hurt anybody ever. And that's where the concern is coming in. So certainly, and they've seen a lot of those cases, and the dogs are deemed in these categories, and they have to have signs up and the fences up and everything when their animal for 10 years never bit anybody until somebody started beating it and they had no right to.
Right.
So
I have two dogs of my own, I'm anti-dog, but like I said,
I definitely agree with your concerns as well.
All right, thank you.
Well, this is a state law. We have no choice to commit. I mean, if you put it out, does it open us to any liability suits?
We might have pulled that on.
Well, the state law obviously is out there already, so there's nothing we can do about that. We just need to harmonize our local code to at least be as restrictive as it is.
It's not necessary. We might get on with that.
Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. We have a motion from the board.
I make a motion, Mr. Chairman, that we accept the new state law into our ordinance.
Commissioner Anderson, may I respectfully just ask that we approve the modifications that's proposed in the agenda.
Approve the modifications that's in the agenda.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, motion of Pam being absent. Item number six, a request of Lanier, Georgia, Inc.
Yes. AZ120013, this is located in Commission District Number 2. The public hearings for Lanier, Georgia, Inc. regarding the amendment of Commission 24, placed on zoning application 3145. The applicant is also requesting variances to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code, Table 11.2B, Chapter 16-4.26E, to allow reductions in the front yard, side yard, exterior yard, and open space requirements. The requested condition modifications are shown on your screen, and the property is located at the northwest intersection of Johns Creek Parkway and Research Court. Also on the east side of Commerce Way, approximately 250 feet north from the intersection of Johns Creek, and was zoned Rust 6 by the Board of Commissioners on October 20th, 2005.
Thank you, Tom. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Move.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tan being absent. Ethan?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Board, and on behalf of Lanier, Georgia. We are requesting to, I guess the short version of it is we're asking you to approve variances pursuant to a revised site plan. This tract is down in the very south part of District 2, Research Court, 141. The history of this property is that it first started off as a condominium development. Then we came back and we revised that and said, well, we're not really sure what we want to do. We'd like the ability to do the townhome dwell project. Well, Lanier, Georgia has finally decided that they have picked up the contract. They were not the original applicant, but at this point, we finally got a developer who says that they know what they want to build and they're willing to commit to that. So they're coming to you and asking you to approve a site plan that should the town will develop. This shows the location. In fact, the Congressional Guinness Fair is the very southern part of the county. Notice, and it's important, this borders the Martin Marietta Mine, which is one of the reasons why the Board of Commissioners felt that was appropriate for registered zoning. This shows the proposed site plan. Now, when you go from a condominium development, if you're looking at the homes, you really can't tell the difference between townhomes and condominiums. It's more of a legal issue. But the simple difference between the two is condominiums, you own the building. Townhomes, you own the building plus the dirt underneath it. So if you're going to own dirt, you obviously have to own a lot. And when we came in and changed from a condominium development and made lots, the problem with that is the setbacks and requirements that you didn't have and affect your open space total. What used to be open space is now part of the lot. So we've come in and we've asked to utilize a very similar site plan design, but also that fits with our townhome requirements. The first three variances that we've asked for, let me get to that for a second. First thing we've asked for, we've got a site plan that says it's pegged to the September 13th, 2005 site plan. The site plan that I just showed you is dated May 29th, 2012. It's on the file. So we're asking to change the zoning condition to reference this particular site plan. With that, we've got four variances. The first three were approved when we came to you in 2010. So we're just asking to reinstate them. We're asking for a front yard variance. Typically in a Res 6, you have a 20-foot front yard setback. We're asking you to go down to 10, before the entire, you'll still have your setbacks from the right of way. So you still have approximately 20 feet from the back of the curb to the front of the home. So you'll have cars backing up or blocking the sidewalks or into the road. We're asking to reinstate that 10-foot front yard setback. Also on the side doors, we're asking to reinstate the variance where you have a minimum of 15 feet between the structure. Now with townhomes, you can have as many as 6 units attached, but then we have these blocks. And they could be as short of this, but 15 feet between, I'm sorry, not structure, but foundations. Again, we'll reinstate the variance that was approved in 2010. Finally, before reinstating, we're asking that you reduce the exterior setback along Research Court, Commerce Way, and the Martin Marietta Mine property from 50 feet down to 25 feet. We'll reinstate what was approved 2 years ago. But as you may recall, we recently changed the code. At that time, variances expired after 12 months. The one change that we're asking to make is to reduce the amount of open space that's required. Typically, a 40% open space required, but now that we've got some of the original open space included in the lot area, it's made it very tight. What's a little different that we have, you notice on this side, it has a different type of detention structure. This is not a detention pond that you see in subdivisions that's fenced in and nobody can use. This is an older form of detention structure. It's been permitted and grandfathered, but kids can go out and skip rocks on it. It retains water, so it's actually designed as an amenity. If we could have used that and counted that detention structure as part of the open space, we'd have much more than 40%. But for technical reasons of the code, that pond has to be excluded from the count, and we've got less than 40%. We feel that based upon the unique situation, the unique detention structure, and also the proximity to a mine and major commercial corridors, that we fit the criteria for variances. The board felt that 2 years ago we fit the criteria for three of those variances, and we're asking you to facilitate this development and the variance to the open space. Again, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have, and we'll reserve the remainder of our time.
I do have a question if you don't mind. You had an item number one, you said you want a 10-foot build line. And then plus you have an additional right of way, which is about 13 feet or 12 feet.
Well, what's being used, what's being proposed is private streets, has been approved. So the pavement itself is going to be 44 feet, and then you have utilities. But so you still end up with 50 feet, but as far as the right of way is 44 feet wide, that's where you start measuring the lot line. So once you're outside of the right of way, it'll be 10 feet from that area, but when you look at the center line of the road and the back of the curb, you're still getting over approximately 20 feet between the front of the house and the back of the curb.
So what would your distance be if they structure it built on the 10-foot line and you come back within the right of way for your utilities, and in that right of way for your utilities for sidewalk, are you anticipating it's 14 to 16 feet from the house to the sidewalk was parked?
It could be, yes.
And what do you think the average length of the cars that are only in the way of a sidewalk?
Approximately 10 feet.
Your car's 10 feet long? My truck's 22. I think the average truck's 17. So I'm afraid it would be the sidewalk for a little bit. Not to pick out, I'm just trying to be realistic.
We all use
the
standard. What would you say?
Looking at cars, I mean, most folks that live in town homes don't have decent trucks sitting out in front of the driveway.
I still think most cars are in the 14 range. So, I mean, you're on the entry in it, so I'm just trying to bring that to light before we vote on this.
They probably don't allow people to, the governments probably don't allow people to leave their cars in the driveway to put the right areas that we have. Maybe during the day. John, what do you?
Well, parking space typically about 9 by 18.
Parking space is 9 by 18. So you beat the sidewalk. It's just a concern to bring that out before we vote on this.
Most HOAs are like that require parking in the garage only except for parties.
I'd like to see if that's in the middle of the day. Because in the middle of the daytime, you're parking.
I'm not
sure. In the middle of the daytime.
Ethan, could you answer a question, please?
Sure.
This isn't really changing the footprint of the building, it's just changing the fee set. Isn't this what was approved before?
This is what was approved before. And I'll remind the commission, we do have a two-car garage. So the hope is that people actually put their cars inside the garage.
Well, then that's fair enough. And I tell you, you got to keep that in mind, guys, because if people are walking the daytime, doesn't matter the night they park their car or not, people are walking right. But it forces them off the sidewalk out into the street or on the edge of the road.
Yeah, that's
and
fair.
And kids on bicycles, such like that. So I don't know how this got approved on time.
There's
got to
be
right
streets.
When was the decision about private streets made?
2010.
And they're just converting these to fee simple, which requires them to have.
I don't know. My concern is that it's hard to believe long term. You know, these people will be able to afford their streets. It says it's a bigger issue than this particular.
But it was already approved for private streets.
No, I understand.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions? Anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition?
I'm Kirk from Michigan, I live in Commonwealth subdivision, I speak only for myself. During this whole presentation, I hadn't heard anyone speak of the number of units. But it seems like when I try to count, there's a lot of units up there. That means a lot of traffic on those roads, and y'all brought up the point just in the very last part. These people are going to be putting a lot of wear and tear on the roads they have. And they should, and I would think there's a very good chance they'll try and have the county take them over. And with that many units, that just seems like a lot of units to me, and not that many roads, and they're going to be putting a lot of wear and tear on those roads. Thank you, Mr. Commissioner.
Anyone else wishing to speak?
Right,
and then you can point something in there, and then the notice to those three units that there's a car wash there, is there any gate?
No problem.
Well, I agree with you.
To Mr. Winterstein's comment, we did want to note that the property is actually approved for 132 units. This plan was dropped down to 120 units. As far as the dedication of the county, we've talked extensively with the engineering department, and they made it quite clear that you have a choice that you can make. If you go in and you build 44-foot wide rights of way, you give up forever your ability to dedicate it to the county, and we acknowledge that. Put that on the record.
That's already been approved on the last plan. It's the private road from 2010.
Is there going to, as far as you can tell at this time, is there a traffic light that will be put out on, I guess, Commerce Way to accommodate the subdivision or?
Commerce Way didn't have that much traffic.
This was actually, it was approved as a precursor to a master plan district. We didn't have a mixed use zone. This is the Scientific Games Research Court area. So you had an intention, and there are actually covenants that were required between all of these. This was the residential portion of it, but when it was originally designed, it was intended to have a mixture of residential, commercial, industrial uses. So there's another overlay of private agreements between all the joint properties.
Does it include red light?
I don't know about that. I don't. John may be able to answer that.
It does not. It would. You know, the additional traffic from this proposed development would justify signalization of intersection.
It would not, as I was saying.
It would not.
I do have a question, Mr. Carroll, just for future reference. What is the right-of-way minimum the county required for the take over? This is 44.
50.
And
50 for a curved residential street and 60 for an uncurved residential street.
And the purpose of us not wanting to take it over to the subdivision. Is it more narrow than what we require?
Can we state that, please?
Why would we not want to take an amendment if it was more narrow than what we require?
It would be our preference that they all be private streets. So if they're willing to agree that these streets will be private perpetually, then we are certainly comfortable with the 44-foot, what it is, ingress, egress, slash utility easement, in lieu of it being right of way. But they understand that when they plat it, then the covenants of their subdivision will never be able to dedicate it to the county. We see it as a win-win. If they do happen to build a private subdivision with 50-foot easements, and at some point in the future, if they decide they want to make them public, then they would have the ability then to deed that to the county, and it would meet our county standards.
How wide is the code for roads on, I guess, the state fire marshal, curb to curb?
Fire department is required 20-foot pavement, and that's what our standard is. With a 24-foot back curb, if it's uncurved, it's 20 feet, so it needs to follow the fire code requirements.
Thank you.
Okay, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. There's no discussion. We vote on the motion, and that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tamley, absent.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the amendment to zoning conditions on CA-3145, TPA Realty Services on Lennar, Georgia Incorporated. Also, the requested variance to the UDC Table 11.2B, Chapter 16.4, about 4.26. And also, the conditions are shown by staff. And the master plan, have you submitted the site plan yet? The site plan is shown on the screen when we approve it.
Yes, sir.
And also with the conditions that lots 107, 108, 109 contain a letter that adjacent to a, I guess it's not a Holiday car wash, a commercial district car wash next door. And y'all will give the lady working on some kind of landscape plan.
Okay. Good. Motion and second. There's no further discussion. Paul, sorry, go ahead.
I could add, we got involved with other things. I did speak with the fire chief. You may recall that we adopted some matters of the matrix. It's not been officially adopted. It's been put on different zones. It said if you go 20 feet between structures, you have to do X. If you do 15 feet between structures, you have to do X. We did speak with the fire department and agreed to implement that on this application. I'm not quite sure. I want to make sure that we're agreeing to that as part of the condition.
Yeah, no, I think we use non-combustible materials.
This was a good one.
How would we reference that, Chief? Please have that.
Chief Shippers, go up to the microphone, please, and take that matrix with you.
Right.
And then we just make this an amendment, or we have to withdraw the second thing we added.
Okay.
Let's leave it second there for right now. Good evening, Chief Shepard. Mr. Stewart, Division Chief. If you like, the condition was that for the side yard variance, that if the distance between foundations is less than 20 feet, then, I'm sorry, it's 20 feet or greater, use general UDC provisions. If it is less than 20 feet, then there's a requirement that there be non-combustible siding, soffits, facing materials, plus openings must be offset or use 1 hour graded windows, casings of glass, and doors. If the setback is less than 15 feet, then we have to agree to use non-combustible siding, soffits, facing materials, plus use 1 hour graded windows, casings of glass, and doors, irrespective of whether openings are offset. For the sake of the clerk, we'll be submitting that same application on PowerPoint presentation with the next presentation, so they still have that on record. We're agreeable to that.
I'd like to amend my motion to include the conditions that read by Mr. Hunwood on this zone.
Hello, sir.
All right.
It is. I just want to confirm that the reason we're going through the variability with respect to the distance between the structures is because of the variance. That's it. That's the side yard primarily.
Yes, sir.
That's fine.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second. We have an amendment and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the amendment. That passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. And now to the main motion. If there's no discussion, please vote on the main motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tandy is absent. Thank you very much. I think we are on to item 7.
Yes, item 7, AZ120014, located in Commission District 23. This is a public hearing for DR 18 regarding the amendment of Commission 13, placement CA3103. The applicant is also requesting a variance for Forsyth County Unified Development Code, Table 11.2B, to allow a minimum of 20 feet between foundations. The applicant requesting conditions are shown on your screen, and the property is located on the west side of Post Road, approximately 565 feet from the intersection of Bellamy Road, and also on the west side of Bellamy Road, approximately 800 feet west from the intersection of Post Road. Moosewood Farm subdivision and was zoned RES 3 by Board of Commissioners on August 18, 2005.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of this evening?
Chairman, members of the board, Ethan Underwood, on behalf of the DR board. We have a subject or a property, it's a large development on Post Road that is subject to three different zoning applications, which is why you see this coming right after the So maybe better to talk about it, the whole, you know, procedure that you have to go with that. Obviously, you follow the county attorney's guidance on that. But I think from ease of understanding, at least we can talk about what we're here for. This property runs from the Victory Springs subdivision on the north, which is just across the street from Midway Park, all the way down to Bend Road. So it's a large tract, you can see. And in fact, you can see the yellow lines that run through the middle of the property. Those are the zoning lines. So the northernmost tract, you've got one section of conditions. In the middle, you've got another set of conditions. On the south part, you've got another set of conditions. We are asking to modify one condition in each of those, each of which say you have to have front side brick or stone. What we're trying to utilize is adopt a condition that allows a craftsman style home. And these are the conditions at issue. The first one, in the southernmost portion of the property, says you have to have brick or stone on at least 75%. Same thing on the middle portion, the northern portion requires front brick. These are elevation drawings. These are actual elevation drawings of DL Horton's one and put one. These are some of them among probably 18 different designs that they're looking to put in a market in this development. They're very attractive on them because you can see they've got differing building materials. So we've developed a, unfortunately long, but very specific zoning condition that we're asking you to substitute in each of the zoning applications that are for you to use this condition. So that way we have a matching zoning condition. The long and short of it is what it says. Whenever you have a lot that's 75 feet or wider, you've got to have a minimum of 35% brick or stone. And then you also add, you have to pick some additional items with that. The only materials that you can utilize on the entire house have to be cement-based, either cement-based shingle, board and batten, or overlap siding, but some type of cement base. We want to make sure that we do not allow vinyl siding to be used on the property. Also, there were some specific limitations. We met with members of the Post Road Committee for Property Development, and they had some concerns about the overuse of overlap siding. So we discussed with them and also with the Commissioner of Event the limitation on the amount of the overlap component. We also discussed the how we calculate the facade, and then also a limitation on board and batten. We don't want to overuse that, so we said that it can be used in a certain percentage of the homes. Also discussed columns, and again trying to further define the craftsman style, so tapering and square columns. Also window shutters and the garage doors that look more like a barn door, kind of puts some hardware on there, so it doesn't like a roll up. So the intention was to give a much higher end requirement to make sure that we are meeting the community desires. Again, we did submit to the county an email from the Post Road Committee for Property Development consenting to this agreement. And here's the catch also. We're asking to reinstate on one portion of the property, southernmost portion of the property, a variance that has expired. Again, we're asking, what we applied for was a minimum of 15 feet between the foundations. This is the matrix that was referenced in the last application. We're agreeable to that as a condition of the variance as well. With that, we're happy to answer questions, Jeff.
Ethan, I got a question, especially at the top. I've seen conditions put on subdivisions before, but this is so specific. Who's going to keep up with this?
You have a very diligent building department and inspectors. They're very, so we work with planning and we work with neighbors to make sure everybody understood what the rules are so that we're all dealing with the same parameters. I think that's going to be something that has to happen in planning. At some point, you're going to have to take account of how much board and batten is used in the property. I think we have to account whenever we submit particular elevations, how that fits. But that's been done, to my knowledge, we've been using for years the percentage
or finished, but not material. Not such things as paper, column, and hinges and things like that. I mean, this we gonna hire an architect to watch you slip it?
We'll leave that at the council.
What's the degree of the paper, Mr. Underwood?
I'm not certain, Commissioner.
Anyway, I'm gonna have fun, but I gotta tell you, this was a little bit challenging, being that the original zoning conditions required full brick or stone. And I've never seen a full house of stone either. So D.R. Horton's asking that they could do the craftsman style home, which seems to be what the market's calling for. And I got multiple emails from the community as well as the advocate groups along this road. And they wanna know if we just allow them and take those conditions away blank, how do we know they can do a craftsman style home? So we sat down with D.R. Horton and said, okay, let's take a look at your plans. And left that up to them, the percentages in which they felt comfortable that their plans were showing. So that we're not forcing them to do anything that their plans they already drew didn't already show. And then from there, sent these copies back to the folks that were concerned. And it seemed that we have everybody's buying at this time. And you're right, I've never seen it this detailed before. But they were very concerned that craftsman style home would actually happen if we removed those full brick stone requirements. Oh, I don't know how they ever got a full stone requirement on a house. I've never seen it this price range before. Anyways, but that's what happened in the past.
This particular, the current zoning condition says that it should be 25%. In this particular one, so
you could have 25% accent, which if you read it inversely, then you have to have 75% brick stone.
Which is, I don't know if you ever seen the house, it's kind of odd in itself too.
I just think getting this specific of anything is going to send headaches far down the road. I mean, if they agree to it, but.
How many walks in this subdivision? 279 will be eventually.
279.
And then we'll have the same type of.
This condition will apply across all 279.
The percentage is set low so that it will easily meet them, but they wouldn't have to be such watch, and we discussed that too, but I'll just let you know.
What happens is the consumer design
wants to square up to the table?
Well, no, the craftsman style home is not always looking at. Things come to go. I mean, the Brady Bunch house was popular at one time, we didn't build one today. What happens if 3 or 4 or 5 years down the road, the craftsman style homes are no longer popular? We end a business and sell a product that's not popular, and then they're going to have to come back and pay more money to change it to meet market standards, market that we're doing at the time. So,
exactly what happened just now.
Respectfully, we're dealing with a condition that was put in at a time. The market's changed, and we've had to come back to. So I'm not searching.
I'm just wondering how that leaves some of us. Really, the free market should dictate what happens in these things. And I'm wondering how this meets free market, around free market, you know, this manifestation.
And also, they agree to it. Which market does vote? Well, that's free market.
Yeah, I don't know if they agree to it. That's free. I had neither, but I can guarantee you, if you ask them if they really want to do this, they would probably say we'd rather not. If you're going to get this passed, this is what you're going to do.
Well, also, too, you can always talk about cutting the red tape out of this. Look at the red tape this has. I think it could be cut down tremendously. I mean, it's going to put a burden on our planning zoning department to keep up with this.
It's nothing against third party inspector.
We would prefer that you not vote against it. We have worked very much with the neighbors and the patient, and we're willing to move forward with it.
We can make a motion that simply says that the exteriors of the homes could be constructed in brickstone, stucco, porcelain, cement material, or a combination thereof, and just let it roll with it.
Well, in particular, dealing with the neighbors, they did not want to see 100% side of houses.
I'm saying
that that's what we tried.
Simply say that there has to be stucco, stone, brick, or cement material, or a combination thereof.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, Commissioner Bell, we pared this down. This is actually as concise as we can get it, and still make sure that we met the members' concerns and make sure we're trying to provide predictability for that and make them feel comfortable with what we're going to.
Did Post Road agree with all the conditions?
They did.
The morning, they wanted to put up?
Post Road, beautiful.
qualifications did not come from the post certification.
Is anybody here with the post certification committee?
I think that just corresponded to the email.
Sorry?
I think that just corresponded to the email.
Is anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this?
Thank you.
Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion?
No, just one more second. Ethan, Mr. Underwood.
Yes, sir.
Is there any way more simpler term and still assure that they're going to get the Craftsman style home?
Can't you just say Craftsman style?
It's too late. Is it going to look at that?
I'm asking you to do that. This is the condition we sent to the neighbors, and they said we're comfortable with this condition.
There's multiple.
How about the early life of recondition, which is talk about front porches, window shutters, and garage doors, and just go with percentage of houses.
Yeah. I'm certain my client wouldn't have a problem, but we gave our word to the neighbors. You've asked for it.
Yeah, I mean, you're more than doing it. They've asked for it. They found a middle ground.
I'm concerned about who's going to police it. I would be.
I don't want to come back calling us for not policing it correctly.
Well, and I'm with you, Mr. I would say if we could leave those last three off, about Square and Taper and Collins, that's not government's job. I can't go there. And I can't. And I just can't. That's not correct. We're not supposed
to. It's the same shutters, it just doesn't get to the basic shutters. And the 50-50, they were thinking they were going to do about 20% square, so we just said, they want 50, give them a bigger window so they wouldn't cross the line they wanted to do.
I would.
You don't like the third one either?
No.
I don't think government should dictate color.
When you mentioned that, they actually did our work, then offered the windows in the garage.
Well, you know, if they want to do it officially, they can, but don't ask us to keep up with it.
Yeah, we should keep up with it.
If they want to honor this agreement, they can.
They can do that.
Yeah.
I don't think we should mandate that. We can't release it. And truthfully, Commissioner, it's not the place of government to mandate color and appearance like that. It's just not. It's free market will dictate.
Yeah, I do agree to an extent, but when they come to you and ask you to change the regional conditions, and this is why we want to do it, to come up with this style home. How do you hold them to what they're saying they really want to do?
Well, you just have to, you've got to trust them on some part.
They're not going to go in and build something that's unattractive because they have to sell these things. They're just not. I mean, to think that they will is just.
Could we ask if we delete the last recondition, will y'all buy it by personally?
I think they intend to, but we also, as we discussed with the neighbors, that D.R. Horton is taking down these lots. It's possible another builder could come in and construct it in the neighborhood. So we can't commit other folks to what they'll do. So the only thing we can do is put an objective criteria out there and say this is the rules, and unless it's changed by the Board of Commissioners, this is what has to be followed.
Right, let me just tell you, Doug, you may not have got the same emails I did from four different neighborhoods over there. A group of people are also involved in the Allen Perimeter gang, including the Post Road Group. I mean, it was quite, I have never gotten contact by so many people over a zoning change before. And it was interesting how they all had the same ideas in mind. And I didn't go to D.R. Horton and say, this is what I absolutely want. I went to them and said, let me see your plans. And they looked at their own plans and their own calculations and found a comfort zone and percentages themselves that they felt they could fall within, and we lowered them so they could fall within them without having to be so policing, if you will. This was not like holding feet to the fire type thing. This is off their own plans and what they felt they were comfortable doing without having to police themselves. And I was most policing so much I felt like this would just fall into place.
Would you be comfortable removing the front porch, taking the column, and the garage door?
And I just want you to know that garage door things are very expensive.
I'm not talking about cost, I'm talking about how do we police it. How do we send somebody out there every time they're going to put it? And remember, this building forever, so if a homeowner changes their door and somebody else complains, we're going to have to send somebody out there.
That turns into a whole
issue. If we take that off there, and we just have to align it that the purpose of this is that all these homes follow a Craftsman style home, if I take those three items off the bottom.
Can you put that they will generally follow the Craftsman style?
Craftsman style homes.
That's right.
a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Pam being absent. Is there a motion from the board?
This is just for one section, we do them all three at the same time.
That may be a better question for your attorney, sir.
Commissioner LeVan, I tell you, from purposes of the Zoning Procedures Act, I don't believe Mr. Underwood needs to make a new presentation for each of these. You all know what he's going to say. I did not even hear any opposition. I think, though, to protect their client and protect the county, you need to go ahead and make one motion at a time, and we'll do a short open and close the public hearing for each one, just to perfect the record. But I don't think Mr. Underwood needs to get up here and do that. That's the thing.
Thank you.
That means it's
going
to hit this one.
I make a motion under the ZA120014, amending ZA3103 under the City Edge Properties, Inc., D.R. Horton, that we approve all zoning conditions as shown, with the following exception: the last three items starting at front porch shall be supported by tapers for columns, and the following two below that are deleted. And we're adding in all house plans will follow Craftsman style construction on the exterior fronts.
Commissioner LeVant, may I ask if Commissioner Bell, if you might withdraw your second, I just want to make sure you hit on the variance. I don't think you indicated that you were approving the variance. Is that right, Mr. Underwood? Does he?
Now, I'm just doing the first one on the first page, and I add to mine and approve the variance. I'm not seeing the number shown.
Move the Forsyth County Unified Development Code Table to allow
them to there you go. So I'm going to add in there to apply the variance to the Unified Development Code 11.2b to allow the minimum of 20 feet between the foundations.
Second.
Are you okay, Council?
That's got it, yes, sir.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Pam being absent. You want us to do a public hearing for each one of these, right?
I do. I think that they've got discrete ZA numbers for each one.
And
I think that would be appropriate.
Public hearing number 8, AZ120015, located in Commission District Number 3. Public hearings for DR Horton, Inc. regarding the amendment of Condition 2 on zoning application 3281. Those conditions are shown on your screen. The property is located on the west side of Road, approximately 1,420 feet north of the intersection of Bentley Road in the Postbrook Farm subdivision, was zoned Res 3 by the Board of Commissioners on September
Second.
We have a motion and a second, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. Is anyone who wishes to speak in favor of Z-8-3281?
Mr. Chairman, the number one will restate all the same facts for the last application. There's no variance in this application. We're approving the same condition as the last one.
Thank you. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, please vote on the motion. Passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. Is there a motion from the board?
I make a motion to approve under the ZA120015 amendment of ZA3281, Harbor Holdings LLC for D.R. Horton Inc. that we approve the zoning amendments as shown, with the exception, and we move out of those conditions starting on the bottom of the page, front porch shall be supported by tapered or square columns, and the next one be removed, and the window shutter shall have a vertical board style, a minimum of 3 vertical boards per shutter, and the garage door shall utilize decorative hinges, panels, and dark tone colors. Will be removed and add, all house plans will follow Craftsman style design on the front elevations. And I'm not seeing that there's a variance condition on this one. Motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Tam being absent. And we're on to number 9, ZA 2938, I believe.
Public hearing number 9. BZ120016, this is located in Commission District Number 3, a public hearing for D.R. Horton Inc. regarding the amendment of Condition 21, placed on zoning application 2938. Those conditions are shown on your screen, and the property is located on the west side of Post Road, approximately 200 feet south of the intersection of Jonathan's Way and Post Road 12 subdivision. It was zoned as 3 by the Board of Commissioners on August 23rd, 2004.
Item number 10. AZ120019.
This is located in Commission District Number 3. Public hearing is for DR Ward 8 regarding the amendment to condition number 13, placed on zoning application 3189. The applicant is also requesting a variance to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code Table 11.2B to allow a minimum of 15 feet between structures on lots and following the subdivision phase 2. Those conditions are shown on your screen, and the property is located on the west side of Fowler Road near the intersection of Atlanta Highway and was zoned as 4 by the local commissioners on March 15, 2007.
Thank you. Of all the conditions and variances you displayed, are we still looking at them? Just that, I thought there were variances on this.
Yes, I do have the applicant's requesting a variance to table 11.2B to allow a minimum of 15 feet between structures on lots in Valley Mill subdivision.
Thank you.
Will we need to read off the new fire requirements on this?
Again, that's up to the Board of Commissioners. We have the building code that will enforce in our department, as we do on all subdivisions. If you think you need something additional above and beyond that, you could add that.
Do you have the new rules in place that you're telling me in less than 20 feet?
Well, we've always had rules in place. There's been cases in the past where the commissioners have felt the need to go above and beyond that based on the proximity of the homes.
I thought we just discussed more recently that we wanted to do everything under 20 feet. Is that not correct?
Some of our recent meetings, we've consistently applied a matrix of standards for when homes are less than 20 feet, separated by less than 20 feet. But I believe, in my opinion, this is still a case-by-case decision made by the Board of Commissioners.
Chief, could I bother you to read that off again to me?
Commissioner, if I have, when we go to the public hearing, we'll actually have that explained.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
There are a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Handy in absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this evening?
Chairman, Mr. Boyd, the number one, have to do our order. Different subdivision. This one's located off of Fowler Road. And what we're trying to do, phase one of this is already been developed, and we're trying to match the building materials in phase two, what's already in phase one. In that, we had some difficulty, all stone work sides, we're trying to come in with a craftsman style home. This is a property located on the west side of Fowler Road, just south of Highway 9. And you can see phase two, phase one's in the lighter shade. It's already built and developed, and we're trying to match the home to phase two. Little cramped, at least you can see the difference. The last sentence regarding water table, that's already in the condition. We're not asking to change that. The only thing we're asking to change is going from the 100% stone or 90% stone with 10% access. We're changing to a minimum of 25% brick, and then you can pick from other materials, including additional brick, additional stone, or cement-based exterior finishes. We did know we ran into a little bit of problems, so we wanted to clarify that windows don't count towards your exterior percentage. So we put that specifically in the condition. And we also put in a requirement that discusses if there can be some accent materials for sheet metal on the tops and the porches. With that, we are asking for a variance. Again, we're comfortable using this as a matrix. No one tells the board how to do it, but if you're willing to accept the condition that we've got up here, it's exactly what you have printed, and want to approve it with our matrix, and we're certainly agreeable to that.
Ethan, I've seen this says the same thing. Can we go back to the previous slide? It says there that homes may utilize metal guttering.
Yes, sir.
That also means they may not.
The intention was, we, as I said, you have a very thorough building department. And we've had folks look at it and say, well, the exteriors have to be built of cement-based material, brick, stone. Well, technically that excludes gutters. excludes glass windows, excludes aluminum skin doors. So we're trying to make sure we cover all the bases, and they know what the rules are, and we know what the rules are.
But that doesn't mean gutters are optional.
No, sir. We just want to make sure that that's it. We don't have to build in that part of it.
Just want to make sure. Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan in the absence. Is there a motion from the board?
There will be. I want the chief to read that off, though, so we can add that fire commission in place. Under the variances where we're changing the distance of it. So I know that we're not part of the motion. Can you go back to chief and I'll let you read it off and accept what you're reading off, and then I'll add in there under the unified development code for the variance. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, board, Division Chief Jason Schubert from Forsyth County Fire. Relative to distance between foundations and required building materials, in instances of greater than or equal to 20 feet, general DDC regulations apply. In instances of less than 20 feet, non-combustible siding, soffits, and facial materials, plus openings must be offset or use 1-hour rated windows, casings and glass, and doors. In cases of less than 15 feet, non-combustible siding, soffits, and facial materials, plus use 1-hour rated windows, casings, and glass, and doors, irrespective of whether openings are offset.
Make a motion to accept the chief's readings in reference to the variance for the Forsyth County Unified Development Code, Table 11.2, to allow a minimum of 15 feet between structures on lots of Fowler Mill Subdivision Phase 2. In addition to that, my motion is to accept the changes to the AZ 120019 for the amendment of AZ 3189 on number 13 as shown.
We have a motion and a second. Now, if there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent. I believe we're on to item 11, AC 12-007 Decom.
Yes, this is located in Commission District Number 2, public hearings for Oxford Properties LLC, regarding the amendment zoning condition number 6, placed on Z824-72. The applicant is also requesting the amendment to condition number 1, placed on the application regarding the major amendment to a PUD on November 12, 2002, and amended on June 5, 2008. The applicant requested amendments are shown on your screen, and the property is located on the east side of Georgia 400 and the west side of Ronald Reagan Boulevard near the intersection of Majors Road and was zoned R3 with a PUD overlay by the Board of Commissioners on December 11, 2000.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent. Anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Chairman, Board, Underwood, on behalf of Oxford Properties. We're asking to make a change regarding the apartment development on Ronald Reagan Boulevard. Currently, the developer has been asked to give additional 10 feet right of way to the county to facilitate some deceleration. The difficulty we have, this shows where the apartment complex is on the south side of the intersection of Majors Road and Ronald Reagan Boulevard. And it's this open space here. This is phase 2 of the apartments. If you look on the easternmost side of the corner, that portion of the property is a PUD. It's the commercial portion of the property. And then following that further to the west is the apartment. For the second phase of the apartment developments, the county's requested that an additional 10 feet of right-of-way be given. This is something that really gets to the heart of it. On the existing site plan, you'll see at the landlot line,
on the commercial portion of the property, we have a 30-foot building setback. On the, once it crosses over the landlot line and goes into the residential portion, we have a 40-foot building setback. Well, if we give the 10 feet of right-of-way to the county for additional deceleration line, that affects the building setback and it pushes everything back. So what we're asking is to amend the plan to create a uniform 30-foot setback. You can see this is the difference. That's the area to dispute. This is the area that makes a uniform 30-foot building setback. That way, we can give the right-of-way to the county to build the structure where they're proposed to be structured. And again, it's easier from an enforcement standpoint because you know the setback on the north side of our boulevard is 30 feet. So what we're asking, we have two conditions that are affecting this PUD plan. The only change is that we changed the reference from the April 23rd, 2008 plan to our May 29th, 2012 plan. But what that's doing, the only change in that plan is shifting that setback so we have a uniform 30-foot right-of-way setback. You have to answer your question, Judge.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
I'll move.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Hamming and absent. Very motion from the board.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the zoning condition amendment CA-2474 Open Group for Oxygen Properties LLC, shown on our screen, presented by Mr. Underwood, AZ120017.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Hamming and absent. Item number 12. Regarding the racetrack, AZ-120018.
This is located in Commission District Number 2, the public hearing for racetrack controlling regarding the amendment, Commission Number 14, placed on zoning application 3047. The applicant requested conditions are shown on your screen, and the property is located at the southwest corner of Ronald Reagan Boulevard, Peachtree Parkway. It was zoned CBD by the Board of Commissioners on May 9, 2005.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
A move. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. Anyone wishing to speak in favor of this?
Chairman, members of the Board of Commissioners, I'm Emory Lips, and I'm here on behalf of the racetrack in this request for a change in zoning conditions to CA-3047 in AZ-120018. Racetrack is a Georgia company that offers quality products as we need them around the clock. They're offering these in very attractive settings. They have a new prototype facility which is located on Georgia 400 in Dawson County, and they want to duplicate that facility at the location that they have chosen, which is near the interchange of Georgia 400 with Highway 141. It's there at the corner of Ronald Reagan in Georgia 141. This is across from the Avenue Forsyth and is a commercial area. Does not adjoin any residential property. It's an area with a lot of traffic and is an ideal location for their facility. The change we're requesting is to item 14. It's condition number 14, sub B. And currently, it reads, the following uses shall not be permitted on the subject property. Subsection B reads, 24-hour businesses except for drug stores, emergency medical facilities, and hotels. And we are requesting to add to those three permitted businesses gas station. So this would be four permitted business that could operate on a 24-hour-a-day basis. That's the way that Racetrack operates its businesses. They're there for us when we need their services. Racetrack will employ approximately 40 people at this location, and of those, six of them will be in management positions. We have the support of the Avenue Forsyth, from Norman Landing, from Union Business Bank, and from San Bernardino Family, which owns the adjoining property there. We're glad to answer any questions. Thank you. I have with me tonight Court Hopkins and other folks from the West Side.
About Cousins' property, we have an issue. Cousins, we have no objection to this.
We have a letter from Cousins' properties in support of those. And we'll give this copy to the Board of Commissioners.
You're going to need it to read also the convenience stores on this form that's listed, gas stations and convenience store?
Well, we left out convenience stores because it was not appropriate because of a limitation in square footage in the definition for a convenience store.
Should we have a gas station?
It's outdated. I think the definition is outdated, and if you go to the racetrack in Dawson County there on Georgia 400, you'll see why it's outdated. That store offers some...
You need convenience stores and the square footage comes into play.
Gas station is analogous to really a gas
station. I'm sure you're covering the station.
Changes to 24-hour businesses except for drug stores, emergency medical facilities, hotels, convenience stores, and gas stations.
I thought, Tom, don't you prefer to say gas stations not completely?
That's okay.
I was comfortable with gas stations after we discussed the morning
okay.
size.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Yeah, he's comfortable with gas stations.
I've been to that store up on 400. There's another one that just opened here in the county as well. Those are some top-notch stores.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just for my own edification, does that mean the gas station, the convenience portion of this gas station is not be open 24 hours?
I would not read it that way. I see it as one product. The gas station being the common draw and all the other uses being a component of that.
Well, no, I mean, when I was a kid, I worked at a gas station that sold gasoline products, period, as opposed to what we generally have now, which is gasoline products and they store to buy snacks and stuff like that. That's what I'm saying. And then the other part is, can a gas station slash convenience store have anything like a restaurant in it and still fit into this? Some of these places are opening up barbecue, little barbecue things that you can sit down and have a sandwich or something.
Look, it would be a bit of a case-by-case examination, but we would look. If we're talking about one primary entrance, one business license, those are all things that would support the fact that it was one product, and we would view it as that and not treat it separately. Now, if there's concern about the retail component, we could modify the wording to say gas stations with customarily provided retail sales of merchandise, but I'm comfortable with gas stations.
That's what I was going to just say, convenience stores and gas stations, because it's kind of a combination.
Well, but he's comfortable with gas stations. He knows
if he's comfortable with, what it is, the racetrack.
Yeah.
It's got a convenience store. It's got
I do, and why I know they don't want to add convenience store is the size.
Right. And so, are we changing this condition for this only, or is this a UDC change?
No, this is only this one.
For this place?
This is variance from my UDC for this station only.
All right, Tom.
That's right. This is not a UDC change.
Okay. Thank you. Is anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this?
Marvin's usually 14.5, they would run here currently. I'm not opposed to the to this at all. I just had a question about the architectural standard. I happened to be about 6 months ago at an Alpharetta City Council meeting, and Race Tractors bringing in their new prototype, and they really look great. And I guess really my question was, is this the same prototype that they were going to build in Alpharetta?
You saw the stacked stone and all that.
Exactly. Yeah, that's plus.
We have a overlay down there.
Yeah. Is there a picture of this in where you can put it? Do you have that?
Same as Alpharetta.
It is. Yeah,
I have that.
Do you have that picture that I saw?
Just yes.
Just so that it's kind of on the record.
Actually, you can bring up a good point. This is in the overlay district, I believe.
Oh, this
is
one.
Okay with that?
There's something called a 141 overlay, and it puts down some real strict building requirements.
Right.
Thank you, Sean.
That's not a gas station.
We want one of those at the north side as well.
I think that's the one we're going to be in this one.
All right. Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Somebody?
We have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner being absent. Is there a motion to amend?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to make a motion that we approve the zoning condition to amendment ZA-3047, Cousin Properties, for Racetrack Petroleum, AZ-120018. The condition was shown by staff, and also the architectural rendering as proposed on the screen and presented by the applicant.
Second.
I guess I have a question. I'm not sure what you mean by the artwork.
Yes.
Just to be the rigor to show us.
And are you
outside the stock
to build this?
They want the city to go build.
Could have that style.
No, it's going to be this style. Right.
You want to take the college?
Hey, who's going to please that?
Yeah,
I'm going to please that. I trust Racetrack.
I think that what the commissioner is saying, and I said, is you have a student appearance.
Student appearance. And he said the same story.
Except we won't mention the
stacked stone. Stacked stone, 25%.
Council, do you have any problems with it?
Black angels?
No.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Yeah,
second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being absent.
Are we going to be using the Sierra in this question?
I have a request for a break.
Does it have a chance for me?
Good.
We can.
How about a 10-minute break?
Yes.
10-minute break.
No, you got a chance.